decays, these are miniatures, and I'm very glad to present Ilya Kachkovskiy from Michigan University.
Michigan State University. State. Okay. Thank you very much. The title of the talk is Bourguignon's method of proving Anderson localization for quasiperiodic operators. Okay, so I'll start from some very basics. The goal of this talk is to consider the simplest case where this method is not trivial and try to give a reasonable amount of details. So I will still skip some steps or maybe leave them as an exercise, but my goal is to make the whole argument sort of believable. Okay, so, and I'll start from really, really basics. I know that a lot of people already know the material on the first several pages. The model that we're going to consider is discrete Schrödinger operators. Okay, so it's operators that act on L2 of Z, complex valued functions, Hilbert space, and it's just a discrete Laplacian plus operator of multiplication by potential. So you can look, the potential will be assumed to be bounded real valued function, so it becomes a self-adjoint bounded operator on L2. So you can look at them in two ways. You can consider this as a finite difference analog of the continuous Laplace operator. In this case, it's natural to add here another term, minus 2 psi n, then it's going to be a finite difference Laplacian. But the term will just shift the whole spectrum by 2, so it's usually people don't write it and absorb it into the potential. But another way of looking at these operators is that they're related to tight binding approximation in quantum mechanics. So if you have some, for example, a quantum lattice like a crystal, and the original Hamiltonian is continuous, but the interaction between the electron and ion is so strong that the electron spends most of the time around one of the ions. And all it can do is like jump from one ion to another. And we can neglect the part where it is between the ions. And so the effective model for the situation is when the position of the electron takes a discrete set of values and it becomes a tight binding model. So it's actually related to physics and it's discussed in textbooks on solid state physics. Okay, so a few things about spectral theory of Schrödinger operators. This is something that people know, most people know here very well. Spectral theory. Suppose you have a self-adjoint operator on a Hilbert space, then you can represent it as an integral over a projection valid measure. So there is a Borel measure, so defined on Borel subsets of R. Its values are orthogonal projections in the original Hilbert space. So its so-called spectral measure satisfies these properties. So measure of intersection is a product of measures and some normalization properties. And then you can represent this operator as an integral of the independent variable or the spectral parameter or the energy with respect to this projection valid measure. And if you are in the finite dimensional space, then you have the usual spectral theorem for self-adjoint matrices. So the matrix is the sum of eigenvalues times the projection on the eigenvector. In this case, this measure is just a sum of delta measures at the eigenvalues of the original matrix, and the values of that measure are the projections of the corresponding eigenvectors or eigenspaces if eigenvectors have multiplicity. Just some basics. And any Borel measure can be decomposed into three components. So the component which is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure, and the singular component. So the one that's singular with respect to Lebesgue measure, and the singular can itself be represented in two other components, the purely point component and the singular continuous component. So purely point is just the sum of all atoms of the measure, singular absolutely continuous is the absolutely continuous part, singular continuous is whatever remains. Okay, and because our projection, our measure is projection valid, so it's not just decomposition of three measures, it's a decomposition to three spaces. So L2 can be decomposed into direct sum, orthogonal sum of three subspaces, such that if you take the original projection valid measure, and consider the scalar measure with respect to a vector from one of the subspaces, the corresponding scalar measure will be of the corresponding type. So point, absolute continuous, singular continuous. Now, I understand that if you didn't know this before, then probably it was too fast. But I just wanted at least technically to be self-contained. Okay. Now, what are we going to talk about? Yeah, next thing. So first, let's talk a little bit about the purely point component of the spectral measure. So if a measure, if you have, so any atom of the purely point measure corresponds to an eigenvector, which is just a regular vector that belongs to L2, like in linear algebra. And in general, if the measure is not purely point, it's hard to talk about eigenvectors. You have to talk about generalized eigenvectors. But there is this nice theorem which allows you at least to say some things about spectral measure in terms of eigenvectors. It's called Schnorr's theorem. Okay, so suppose that you have a vector which satisfies the eigenvalue equation. So right now it's just a sequence, psi is just a function in Z, it's not necessarily the element of L2. So then it's called a generalized eigenvector. It's called generalized eigenvector if it satisfies this bound. So if it goes at most polynomially. Here I say, okay, so go power 1/2. So this is the specifics of one-dimensional situation. In general, you can say D over 2 plus epsilon. Okay, so if this function satisfies this property, it's called, in our case, a generalized eigenvector. And then the important theorem by Schnoll, Emmanuel Schnoll, is that, and the corresponding energy is called a generalized eigenvalue in this case.
This
formulation is meaningless. So basically, I think the correct formulation is the following, that you can choose epsilon in the beginning as small as you want, and the statement still will be true. So the spectral measure will support on the set of eigenvectors, generalized eigenvectors with arbitrarily small epsilon. Yes. So what's written doesn't make much sense. So let me state it a little bit more correct. So let's call let's fix epsilon first, and call a sequence with this property and generalize the vector of type epsilon. Then Schnorr's theorem says the following: that for every epsilon, the spectral measure is support on the set of generalized eigenvectors of type epsilon. Yeah, thank you. And if dimension is higher, then you have to make a power higher here. For our applications, it will not be really important. It's only going to be important that this thing is polynomially bounded. So I think actually for everything we're going to talk about, even this statement, this meaningless statement will be enough. So all we will need is that it grows polynomially. We will not really need effective bounds like this. Okay, so the spectral measure of H is supported on a set of generalized eigenvalues of H. So I'll give this theorem without proof if I read this mini course too fast and I still have time. I can give you the proof in the very end of the last lecture. I will prepare it. Почти каждая точка суда множества спектральной меры ноль. Okay. So, informally, what does it mean? It means that if you study only energies which correspond to generalized eigenvectors, you don't really lose any information on the spectral measure of the operator. The complement has spectral measure zero. Okay, so what are we going to talk about? We will be talking about purely point spectrum. So we'll try to prove the spectrum of some operators purely point. And more precisely, we'll talk about Anderson localization. Anderson localization is when an operator has purely point spectrum with exponential decaying eigenfunctions. So how exactly they decay, we'll talk a little bit later, but for now, exponential decay. Okay, so thanks to Schnell's theorem, this is what's sufficient to prove to establish purely point spectrum, that any generalized eigenfunction decays exponentially. So because the remaining because then you'll have a set of real eigenvectors, true eigenvectors from R2 of Z, and the set of the corresponding eigenvalues will have full spectral measure, which will mean that the spectral measure is purely point. So this is the main part, how to reduce localization to study of generalized eigenfunctions. Okay, so there is a lot of discussion about Anderson localization, and for this course I chose not to give any references in the slides because there will be too many, but actually prepared a PDF document with a list of references that I will use. I'll send it to everyone like maybe later today. Yeah. You can send it, right? Okay. And also maybe depending on the discussion, I might have to add some references also. So that's why I'm not sending it in advance. Okay, so originally, Anderson localization was related to Anderson model, which is showing the operators with potentials that form a sequence of independent, identical, distributed random variables. So it's a random operator. We'll talk about quasiperiodic operators. So let me skip to quasiperiodic operators. Okay, so okay, this is where we have like a break in slides. So let me. Pure analytic. One periodic. I can't remember if I said it in the slides, but yes, I assume that V is a real analytic function on the. Oh, okay, so I said on T. Yeah, in this case, you don't need to say one periodic, but you can say also R. So R, then it will be one periodic. Okay. So suppose that V is such a function, and assume, for simplicity, it has bounded by one holomorphic extension into the strip. Okay, let me get my pointer. Battery maybe not very good. Okay, yes, so originally it's a real analytic function on the real line with real values in the real line. So any real analytic function which is one periodic can be extended to a strip, right? So in general a strip can get smaller and smaller as you go far away in the real line, but if it's periodic it's not going to happen. So the strip will have finite width. And for simplicity, let's assume that the strip has width 1. So all the arguments can be sort of rescaled if you change the size of the strip, although it's not completely trivial because you don't rescale the period. But it can be done, and let's also assume that the function is bounded in L infinity by 1. This can be just done by changing the coupling constant, so this is not a big deal. Okay, so then a quasiperiodic Schrödinger operator is an operator with a potential which is obtained by taking our function, multiplying by coupling constant, and then generating a sequence of real numbers by taking the trajectory of the irrational rotation. So you have sequence x plus n omega, an integer. So for any x, you get a sequence of real numbers, and that gives you an operator. And when we talk about quasiperiodic operators, usually you consider family of operators parameterized by the initial point of the trajectory. Okay, so, and here I also defined what a Diophantine frequency is, although technically we will not need this definition until probably like maybe 1 hour at least. And when we do, I will actually use a different definition. But still, a lot of let me just say that a lot of results about quasiperiodic operators require some kind of assumption on the frequency, and one of these assumptions is the Diophantine property. That okay, so defined by norm of n omega, this is notation I will be using a lot. Distance from n omega to the integers, so to the nearest integer. It's basically a fractional part or one minus fractional part. And a frequency is called Diophantine with parameters c and tau if the distance has this following lower bound. So an omega to z bounded by some negative power of m. So it doesn't get too close to integers. Or in other words, you cannot approximate omega too good by rational numbers. So to approximate omega really good, you need a rational number with a very large denominator. And important property of Diophantine frequencies is that, okay, so let, this is not really going to be important, but I think I want to mention. So let tau greater than 2, then union over all c, dc, c tau, has full Lebesgue measure. Okay, so basically, if you are able to prove something for fixed tau and all c, you get full measure set of frequencies. Okay, now, the main theorem that I would like to prove, or at least give the main steps of a proof. So I'll first state the theorem and then explain some context in which it appears. Okay, so first, assume that V satisfies the properties that we can almost see above, that it's this properties plus extension to the strip. If it's not extendable to this kind of strip, it will affect the constants. So that's just the simplest possible form. So fix some potential with this property. Then for lambda greater than or equal to lambda zero of V, so for sufficiently large lambda depending on the of V, every initial point x0, and dependent on x0, almost every omega. Then this operator H has Anderson localization. So there are different ways of stating it. So for example, point, yes. Exactly, yes, that's correct. Yes. So another way to state it, although slightly weaker, is that it's true for almost every pair x0 omega. So for almost every pair frequency. Well, okay, so omega is actually not just Diophantine. So it's a little bit unfortunate. So I mentioned the Diophantine condition because it appears in many other situations here. Okay, omega will be assumed to be Diophantine for first half of the proof, and in the second half of the proof we have to impose an additional restriction, which will remove another zero measure set, which is not described arithmetically anymore, and which will depend on x0. So it will be Diophantine plus something extra, so it will be stronger than Diophantine. Yes, so you can restate it by saying that it's true for almost every pair of x0 omega. This is slightly weaker because with this statement you cannot catch every x0. And you can also apply Frobenius again and say the following, that for almost every omega, it will be true for almost every x0. So the last statement is important because, okay, so some motivation for this operator is that it's ergodic operators, and then x is considered as sort of a random parameter, like a sample of random variable in the Anderson model. And then you probably don't want a result that holds for only one sample of random parameters. You want a result that holds for almost every x. And I'll also mention that later. So, but this version of the theorem includes that part as well. So you can remove zero measure set of omegas, so that for the remaining omegas, the result will be true for almost every initial point. Okay, so this is the main theorem. Our goal is to discuss its proof. Let me give several remarks. Yeah, please, are you already asking questions? But feel free to ask, stop me anytime and ask questions. Okay, so remarks. Let me leave the theorem first. Okay, this is not the strongest original form of the theorem. In fact, it was established, so the description for lambda zero can be made more explicit. So to do it, we need to introduce Lyapunov exponent, which I will not do. And then lambda zero, and then you can prove that for sufficiently large lambda zero, Lyapunov exponent will be positive, eventually on the whole real line. But yes, and then the actual statement of the theorem says that if you have an interval of energies where Lyapunov exponent is positive, then you have other localizations in that interval. So that the spectral measure inside that interval is of the type that we discussed. Yes, and the separate statement is that by choosing large lambda, you can make Lyapunov exponent positive. So here I will combine this into one statement without defining Lyapunov exponent. And there are several reasons for this. First, it's a little bit more simple. Second, Lyapunov exponent is something that you can define only for the case, for example, of regular discrete Laplacian and in one dimension. There are some models, for example, you can take operator with, instead of Laplacian, you can take like an operator of infinite range, so that the hopping, not necessarily nearest neighbor, but next nearest neighbor and further. Then you cannot talk about Lyapunov exponents really in this case, but you can, but it's much more complicated and there are no such results. But this method still works. And second motivation is that currently a lot of people are interested in multi-dimensional models where some much more complicated version of this method is developed, and there are no hope of defining anything like Lyapunov exponents. So I want to avoid talking about Lyapunov exponents. Okay, so, and around the same time in 1999, so the story was basically that Zhytomyrskaya first studied almost matrix operator, which is an operator with a special potential. So I mentioned here the work in 1999, but there were several iterations, it started maybe in earlier 90s. So, and the results of Zhytomyrskaya were the first results where you can prove something for a full measure set of frequencies. So something like this. Not exactly, but something like this. Previously, let me mention, yeah. Okay, yeah, I have a remark about it. So the kind of revolution in the proof of Anderson localization is when people went from perturbative to non-perturbative methods. Perturbative methods are basically methods based on KM theory. So I will not mention the exact statement. I'll have some references in the PDF file. But basically, the common feature of this method is that it's an iterative process which starts from the initial iteration, and the largeness of lambda on the initial iteration depends on the Diophantine constant C in the frequency. So the smaller C is, the larger initial lambda you have to choose. And so you will never be able to cover, use the same lambda, which will cover full measure set of frequencies. You always have to remove something from a positive measure. And it was discovered by Zhytomyrskaya that for almost matrix operator, you can do it non-perturbatively. So for full measure set of frequencies, originally it was something like lambda greater than 8, but then after some iterations, it was pushed to the theoretical limit lambda greater than 1, then there were many other results which refine this thing. And then Bourdain learned about this proof and came up with an approach that proved weak results. So as I mentioned, you have to remove stuff beyond the Diophantine condition, but then the method can treat any relative potential. So, and since then, a lot of people worked on non-perturbative methods. And another nice thing about this is that, okay, so KEM, in a way, so all quasiperiodic results based on KEM, in some sense, are one-dimensional. So even if the operator is on lattice, the potential is still one-dimensional function. And sometimes you want to treat sort of true multidimensional potential, where the when the lattice has multiple dimensions, so the torus also has multiple dimensions. And I think people tried to do it by KEM and couldn't, but these methods actually have extension to higher dimensions. But in that case, they become perturbative. So these methods not only prove strong results in one dimension, they, in a way, they kind of easier to understand, which makes which made it possible to discuss multidimensional models. So I think the reason that KEM was not developed in high dimensions is just because it becomes too hard, very, very technical. Maybe it may be possible to do. Okay. Some more, okay, so the last remark about quasiperiodic operators is that, yes, so it's quasiperiodic operators is a particular case of ergodic operators. So the spectrum of the operator H of X as a set that don't depend on X. The components of the spectrum are independent of X almost surely. So this is part of any basic course on ergodic operators. And in general, in our situations, you can't remove almost surely. So for random operators, it's kind of obvious. You can always have a sample of random variable, which, for example, gives a constant potential that does not have localization. It's absolutely continuous. And turns out that for purely point spectrum, so maybe not in the generality we're discussing, but in many cases, you can actually prove that you cannot have point spectrum for all x. You can only have it for almost all x. So at least some of these almost everythings are necessary. In particular, for almost matrix operator, you cannot prove localization for every x. It's just not true. You'll have singular continuous spectrum sometimes. Okay, that was sort of an introduction. Now let's talk about the techniques. You have a question? Да. Ну, должна быть, да, но в каком-то смысле X считается случайным параметром.
Померили
бега, да. То есть в пространстве the parameter space for the operators is one-dimensional torus with the standard high probability measure. So Lebesgue measure, yes. Yes, and so because of the intuition from ergodic operators, some people use probabilistic terms to discuss them. Even though, well, you can kind of say that X is chosen randomly, sort of. But the real motivation is random operators, where the parameter space is not the torus; it's a product of countably many tori, and then you have a real probability space. Like a Markov process or something. So this is just a language which comes from ergodic operators because of the relation to random operators. Yeah. Yeah, so almost surely means for now almost every X respect to the Lebesgue measure. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the techniques. The techniques here are one of the main objects of this proof is Green's functions. Okay, so again, Green's function is a little bit of a language which comes from PDEs originally. So consider, another a little bit of abusive notation is that I will often use notation AB to denote intervals on Z. So operators here will be on the lattice and I will say AB instead of AB intersection Z, just for shortness. So this denotes finite set A, A plus 1, blah, 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 D. Okay, so in HAB of X is just a restriction of our operator onto this subspace on this interval with Dirichlet boundary conditions, which, if you abuse notation a little bit, can be written just as this matrix. Well, except that I forgot to put lambda in front of potential. But other than that, it's this. Or maybe we're just talking about general quasi-political operators here anyway. Okay, so then because it's an ergodic operator, so if you translate the operator on the lattice, it's the same as translating the argument of V by the vector translation, you can kind of state the following property that HAB of X, so to study HAB of X, it's a feeling to study operator H on the interval 0, B minus A, but change the parameter. So as a consequence, instead of continual restrictions of on all possible intervals, we just use interval that starts from 0, and then assume that we study it for all values of the parameter. Then from that you can recover all restrictions to all intervals. Okay, so then the Green's function of the operator H is just basically the inverse operator, the inverse matrix, if it exists. So in this case, Green's function is an operator, and if you want to match, have a question?
Is it matrix?
Yes, if Green function is the matrix, it's a matrix. Okay, so that's a little bit of a good notation. So. Yes, oh, thanks, yeah, okay, that's good. I always forget E. Okay, so sometimes I will also talk about Green's function as the collection of elements of the matrix, so which is a function of two integer variables. Okay. And then, okay, here I had E. Okay, so suppose you have a generalized eigenfunction. So suppose that H psi equals E psi. So solution of the eigenvalue equation. Then you can restrict this equation into the interval 0m. And then you almost get the same equation for the restriction of that operator, except that because the restriction will get some boundary terms. So then we'll get boundary terms like this. And that gives you something which is an analog of Poisson formula. So you can recover the value of psi for any point inside the interval. So n is, I didn't say it here, but n is between 0 and. You can recover the values of psi inside the interval from the boundary conditions using the Green's function, using the elements of the Green's function. So just apply HMSP, move this E to the left-hand side, apply the inverse operator. These are the matrix elements. So matrix element N0, matrix element N, and capital minus 1. Yeah, so this just inversing a matrix. Okay, so... And do you have a question?
Arguments, E, N, and 0.
Okay. Yes, okay.
Confusing.
Well, okay, yes. So, I mean, to complete consistency of notation, I should have... Yeah, I have omitted X at some places which with no particular reason. Okay, so in general, Green's function has four arguments. So it has energy, X, and two integer arguments which enumerate the matrix elements. So if you have two arguments in X, then it's just a matrix. So sometimes I omit X because I think here I pretend that I'm talking about general Schrödinger operators, not quasi-periodic, but then I accidentally added X here, and then I removed it here, but then I added it here again. So yeah, I should have fixed the notation a little bit. Well, if this is the worst problem, this is good actually. Okay. So, and what's the main idea of these techniques? Is that let's call green function good if its matrix elements. Okay, here again. So I did the wrong notation. I was changing it from one to another. So this n and n prime is supposed to be also inside the parentheses. Well, but I hope it's clear. Okay, so the green function is called good if it decays exponentially away from the diagonal. Well, yeah, so let's say here's n over 20, it's basically some parameter which will depend on the proof. But n over 20 is okay. I think at some point I will change to n over 50. So there would be a lot of situations like this where you just introduce a large integer parameter. Yeah, anyway. So.
And there are no constants in front of.
Yes, the constants can be absorbed for large n, they will be eventually absorbed into this n over 20. So. You can put constants, yeah. I mean, I'm just illustrating the idea, so I'll try to be more precise later, maybe. Yeah, so the idea is that the green function has decay away from the diagonal. So for example, if n minus n prime is at least n over 10, then this thing has exponential upper bound. And if n very close to n prime, we assume that it doesn't explode too much. So the norm of this matrix is bounded by something of the order e to the
lambda.
Yeah, lambda is the coupling constant. So, yes, for the purpose of this proof, you can actually, yeah, so this is actually also a little bit complicated. So in some proofs, this constant changes from scale to scale.
So the right-hand side does not depend on.
Yes, so we will prove it for fixed E, and then there will be some uniformness bounds. Yeah, so right now I'm just illustrated, so I'm not really like pretending I'm proving something. I want to illustrate the idea. Okay, I want to copy this. Для всех. Ну, в общем, для всех на спектре. Well, not really. So actually, what can depend on E is, well, we'll see. But I think actually, well, the worst thing can depend on E is that for how large n this thing starts to be true. But even that might not actually be. I think we might be able to do it uniformly. So I cannot promise I will follow all the constants because there are just too many. Yes, but let me. Okay, so I want to copy this on the board because I want to scroll the slides. So, how to use it? And let me also copy the Poisson formula, sorry. so how to use this? Suppose that we know that the green function is good.
And the first four in this line is equal to 1.
Yes, that's also true. Sorry. A lot of typos. This is for number 5. Okay, so if the function is on the interval is good, and psi is a generalized eigenfunction, so then we can use Poisson formula and show that inside of this interval it will decay exponentially at some rate. I don't know, maybe like 10 over 20. Because the original function psi it grows at most as a power of n, and then this power is killed by the terms of the green function. So if the point where we measure the function is not too close to the endpoints, then the exponential decay of green function compensates the power growth of psi. So then we get the exponential decay. And then the game in the end is to choose the boxes appropriately, so that you can get exponential decay in every point. So you have to choose the box of appropriate size, so basically for every sufficiently large point n, I need to find a box of sufficiently large size with the center of the box not too close, with the point not too close to the edges of the box, of the interval, such that the wave function is good. And then you can get the decay. So the size of the box should be comparable to the position of the center of the box. Okay. So there is something about resolved events, which I think I will just skip for now. Yeah, okay, so but this is actually the one of the most important original ideas, is that you prove the decay of the eigenfunction formula. You start from a generalized eigenfunction, which grows as a power. So then, for each point, you find a box of sufficiently large size, such that the point is not very close to the edge of the box. And then you use this identity to show that the function decays exponentially.
You will prove now that its identity is zero. No,
because the box. Okay, so the box will not necessarily start at the origin. So the boxes will be, I know this is zero, the box will be like this. So as you go away on the integer axis, the box size will grow, but the box will not necessarily overlap the origin. Yes, and then you have to basically carefully choose the position of the box. But there will be many, many preliminaries involved. Okay, so actually, okay, so what is it? Do you want to have a break now or in 5 minutes? There's like a logical pause here, maybe we can now.